wage war against the Lamb, but the Lamb will overcome because he is Lord. He is the King of Kings, and all those who are with him are called chosen.
Good morning, Grow family. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord. We got our worship collective up here. How about everybody just stand and we worship our King this morning, huh?
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in all his wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. Yeah, my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
That's good news, church. Sing this with us.
Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what he started. Yes, our God will finish what he started. Oh, this is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe.
This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'll testify. This is my testimony. Oh, I is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
Yes, Lord, who bow down and say you are.
Father, thank you for your faithfulness despite my faithlessness. Thank you for being you, Lord.
Walking around these walls,
I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet.
How many know he's never failed?
Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness, I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
Thank you, Jesus.
I know the night won't. Your word will come to pass, and my heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. Oh, my heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence.
Sing this out to him.
I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. And I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. And I believe I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it
faithfulness.
I'm still in your hands.
Let the King of my heart be the
so, so good to us, Lord. We don't deserve it outright. None of us deserve it. No one can come in here claiming to deserve the goodness you've shown us, the faithfulness you've shown us, the kindness, the mercy, the love, the grace. No one can claim these things. Lord, if you were simply a man-made idol or a man-made God, you would be useless. Forgive us for making those idols, either in our hearts or actually making the idols of physical things. God, you are the one true God. The one true God, the only one who can do anything. And God, we call on you today as if you have not done enough for us already, just bringing us in this building. Lord, just keeping us alive, and then not only physically alive, but bringing most of the people in this room from death to life. Lord, as if that wasn't enough, we call on you this morning and ask that you use us. Use us to bring you more glory. Lord, that is what we are on this planet to do. It is what we are alive to do, and that is to bring glory to your name. Lord, we lift you up this morning. I pray for Pastor Ben that you would light a fire in him and let him bring the word of God. Bring your word to people this morning. And God, that you, through Pastor Ben, through the power of your Holy Spirit, would change lives. But once again, all for your glory. We love you, Father. Thank you for this time. Prepare our hearts to receive what you have for us. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen. Let's praise the Lord this morning. He is worthy. He is worthy of praise. God be praised. It is an honor to bring God's word to you today. And on this very cold day, they had a lot of factors against it: daylight savings, ice, snow, all of that. It's so good to have you here, and I appreciate those that led us in worship. Worship leaders of all ages, and I praise the Lord for them. Just praise the Lord for them. Today, we continue our series on I1N 2.0. And today, we examine the man from Ethiopia that we began last week. Last week, we emphasized to preach the gospel. Preach the gospel wherever you go. Preach the gospel no matter where the Lord takes you. And to run to the center of God's activity, preach the gospel. What's the Lord doing? I don't know. But he's moving in this direction. What should we do? I don't know, except for one thing. Preach the gospel. Just preach. I remember growing up and I had those little toys that we would get. And if you remember these toys, they were kind of suspension, kind of rubber band underneath. And you'd wind them up and wind them up. And then they get really tight. And all of a sudden you'd let them go. And they'd go in that direction. The wheels would spin. But if you were good enough, you could get two rides for one, because if it hit a wall and you picked it up, it'd still be spinning. You'd turn it here, and it would zoom. And then you could turn around here, and it goes zoom until the suspension stopped, and you have to wind it up again. And that's exactly what Philip did in this passage. You want me to leave Jerusalem through persecution, go to Samaria? Wind me up. Boom, he goes here, he preaches the gospel. You want me to walk down to a desert street in Gaza? Okay, I'll just go and preach the gospel. I want you to go to that chariot, and I want you to walk beside him and talk to him. You'll know what to do when you get there. Okay, Philip ran and went there, and then we'll find that he went even north to a Palestinian city. He just went wherever God directed him, and when he got there, he just preached the gospel. The church, to honor the Lord, is very simple. Just preach the gospel. But as you heard sung this morning, intentionally, and as you heard Chad pray, today we're going to look under the hood a little bit at this passage, and we're going to learn the culture and the background and deep theology that Dr. Luke wrote when he wrote the book of Acts, and we're going to learn a little bit of the the background and the details. So this will stretch some new believers. This will hopefully enhance the worship and bring depth to those of us who have been in church for some time, because we're going to see. Last week was shining the light on God can save anyone, an Ethiopian man, just like light. But today we're going to put the prism. We're going to diffract the light. We're going to see the finer shades of light and meaning now in the story. We're going to break the vividness open to see two things. When you run to the center of God's activity and preach the gospel, when you run to the center of God's activity and preach the gospel, when you run to the center of God's activity and preach the gospel, two things must be swirling in your head. It is not about me. It is all about God's glory. And all God's people said, amen. It is all about God's glory. Just, you hear this phrase, John the Baptist says, he must increase, I must decrease. Philip's going to say, you, Lord, must increase and I must disappear. For I want the people whose lives have been changed to rejoice whether I'm present or not. He must increase and we just fade away. Because it's not about Philip, it's not about us. You share the gospel, God gets great glory and praise. In doing that, you must be very flexible. And you must love people. That's the second thing. Today in this passage, we're going to learn that you do everything for God's glory. You run to the center of his activity. You got to be flexible to do it. You may not know what he's got in store. But when you get there, you just preach the gospel. You kind of discover what God's doing. And you just share the gospel. And you give him all glory. And you disappear. You get off the scene so people can focus on the Lord and not you. But while you're there, second, you have to have a love for people. People of all types. People of all types. We often say in this church service, and we will at the very end, you know we make this house into a house of prayer. That comes from Isaiah. Comes from a passage in the New Testament. Well, it says, my house will be a house of prayer. John 2, for all nations. It doesn't mean that all philosophies come into the house. It means that everybody in the world is welcome into the house to worship the one true God. So anyone is welcome to receive the glorious gift of salvation, which last week we emphasized so clearly, that man has sin, man can't forgive himself. We needed a man to forgive us, but no man can. Only God is perfect, only God can forgive sins, so we needed a God-man. That's exactly what God did. God wrapped himself in flesh, came to this earth. We named him Jesus while he was here. He lived a perfect life, took all of our sin upon the cross and said, I will take everything you've ever done, doing, or going to do, and I will pay for your sinfulness that you could not wash yourself. And I will die and I will pay that sin, but then I will prove I can pay that sin by rising 3 days later, and I will prove that I can overcome sin and death, and then I offer that salvation to whoever calls upon my name. This house is a house of prayer for anybody. And today we are going to see in the first century, Philip talked to a man who at that time in history lived at the quote end of the earth, Ethiopia. In fact, travelers would say that Ethiopia were where the land was where the descendants rested, where the sun rested. They thought it was the utter end of the earth. Today we're going to read about a man from Ethiopia who traveled through Jerusalem and he was on his way back. That is a startling statement in and of itself. Rome's in power. Rome doesn't like international travelers, especially leaders. They got woken up when the Magi walked into town. Magi from Persia, current day Iran. The Magoi were people that they would consult to determine who would be the kings of the Orient. And they walk into your town and say, where is this king of the Jews? No. You can travel in the Roman world, but if you're a leader, we kind of brace. So now we have an Ethiopian who is the head of the finance minister that works for the Queen of Ethiopia, a country that has fought back the Roman Empire. The Roman world conquered Egypt and could not conquer Ethiopia. It was run by women. Maybe that's why. The male king was determined to be a god. He was the son of the sun god, S-U-N, sun god. So he was not to be disturbed by details and menial tasks, oh, like running a country. He was too busy being a godlike figure. So the wife of the king, the queen, was given a title, Kendake. Kendake meant great woman and often applied to the queens. The queen before this story was the one that stood off the Roman Empire after they conquered Egypt. Now, if you know your geography, you have Israel and you have the Mediterranean Sea, and you have Jerusalem here and you have Israel. At the bottom of Israel, it borders Egypt, still does today. You have a little strip touching the Egyptian border, and that is called the Gaza Strip, still exists today. This is where the story takes place. And then when you get into Egypt, you'll notice that when you go into Africa, the next country is today is Sudan, and the next country is Ethiopia. But back then, Sudan was Ethiopia, and a little bit of the southern portion tip of Egypt. Rome comes in, conquers Egypt, overwhelms its wealth, so it's got all the Roman world, all the power and all the wealth, and then it hits the borders of back then Ethiopia, and they stood them down again and again and again. Finally, there got to be this demand on resources, and Rome had more resources than Ethiopia to still push. So finally, they came up with an agreement. They said, fine, you can say we're part of your territory, but that's all you get, lip service. We will not pay you tribute. We will not honor your Caesar. Remember, Caesar is a title. Augustus is a title for high one, high supreme one, God. We will not honor your God. We will still acknowledge our God. So you can say we're part of your territory, but that's it. We have our own rules, our own finance minister, our own rulers, our own military, everything. They're like, fine, great, because Rome had a little pride in them. They don't like getting beat. So the very next queen is the one in this story, where this Ethiopian is the head of the finance. He's the finance minister, the chancellor exchequer is what they call it. He was over all of the accounts of the king and queen. He worked closely with the queen. In order to do that, he had to demonstrate that he was trustworthy, so he conditioned his body to where no one would distrust him or no one would worry about him, and he worked close to the ruler of the country. And that guy's walking in your country. Interesting. 30 years or 35 years before this, they did not like the Magi coming in. There were other leaders that tried, some from the Orient historically, but they didn't make too far progress. And now here's a guy coming in, and he's on his way out. That means he was in, he made his business, and then went out. So this man is here for a reason. But we're going to learn in a moment his reason was unique. He wanted to worship. Worship. Why would you want to worship? You have your gods. You could go see the Ethiopian pyramids today. They still had their gods. His king was a god. Why do you want to worship? To the Roman Empire, the Jewish people are this group that always caused Rome problems. They were so precious and valuable within the Roman Empire that whenever a Roman ruler was assigned to that area, they said, let them do their religious thing, just keep peace. That's why in the scriptures in the book of Acts, it often said when Jews would take someone in the Jewish area to their civil courts, like in Acts 18, they would say, well, you have your courts, just settle on this and go, you have your Sanhedrin, go dispute this yourself. They would never break up mob riots. That's how a Stephen can get stoned. That's how Jesus often they can attempt to stone because they're just like, you know, let's call this a mob riot and let's just not get in the middle. Let's just kind of contain it as well. So when Jesus, if you recall, was being crucified and they were trying to get Pilate not just to scourge him but to crucify him, they turned to the Roman leader who historically had, the Jews had run to Caesar twice and said, you know, this leader's causing, he's not keeping peace. He's not letting us do our religious stuff. So right before the Jesus account, Pilate had been warned, one more problem and you're out of office. So what did they say? They said, if you don't crucify him, you're no friend of Caesar. And he may hear that. For political reasons, he cuts down. They were so frustrated at the Jews. Now a foreign leader is coming into the Roman country to worship their religion. You remember in about 68 AD, Nero declared Christians that could be killed without permission. Why? Because they were atheists. And you're like, atheists? What in the world is that? Because they said Caesar is not a god. You're breaking the law, you can kill him. So this foreign ruler is coming into a portion of our world who's starting to get bold, because about 3 years ago from Acts chapter 8, this whole group's starting to tout that there's a king of the Jews, a guy that rose from the dead. So now I've got this group in the Roman Empire who's starting to say that this Jesus, this Jesus of Nazareth, rose from the dead. 30,000 people are starting to join this club here, this belief system. And now I've got religious rulers coming into town. This is not good. So what's going to happen? Rome is watching this. And they're concerned about this travel route. But see, make no mistake, I'll say something I know you already know. Proverbs 16:9, man can make his plans, but God directs the steps. You cannot go against the hand of God. You cannot mock the hand of God. God's will be done. You will see God's sovereignty in the story. You will see his control. You will see his providence, which means not a miracle, but orchestrating details. You will see God's literal activity here. And he's got all of this in play because he is about to start, God is about to start a revival of Christianity in Ethiopia. And can you imagine Philip in the Samaritan masses? He just rebuked Simon Magus, the magician. He just said that Peter and John came and they confirmed that all the Samaritans began to accept Christ, which were half Jew, half Gentile, not fully Gentile. And all of this crowd in Samaria is all getting saved. And then when Peter and John went back to Jerusalem to report, it says that there were many towns on the way and they went preaching the gospel back on the way to Jerusalem. And you've got all of this. And then God says, I want you to leave the crowds, the conference, the big lights and the cameras, and I need you to walk 40 miles to a desert road. I'll tell you what you'll do when you get there. What if Philip said no? Why would you want me to leave this? It doesn't make sense to me. And we've learned, you run to the center of God's activity. You trust that God's got something. It's not for us to know. Run to the God's activity, be prepared and ready to share the gospel, and just stand by and watch what God's going to do and how he's going to direct. What if Philip said, no, I'm sorry, I need to be a part of this decision, or I need to know all the details before I go. I need to be in on the decision-making process. I mean, I'm just quoting stuff church people say, by the way. I need to know. I need to understand. I need to declare this first. It's inconvenient for me because I really like the Samaritan area. This is new and I don't understand it. And he is about to start a revival. And this guy's leaving Gaza. He's leaving town. And you better get to him. But Philip had no idea. So he walks 40 miles to the coast of the Gaza Strip right before he gets back into Egypt. And we pick up our reading there. Acts chapter 8, verses 26 and following. It says, as for Philip, he's in Samaria, an angel of the Lord said, go south down to the desert road that runs from Jerusalem to Gaza. So he started out. He met the treasurer of Ethiopia, a eunuch. It's the title of a man that conditioned his body to be trustworthy around powerful women or a lot of women so they could trust his leadership. Great authority under the kandake, that's the title for the queen. Then the eunuch, verse 27b, the eunuch had gone to Jerusalem to worship. Now stop right there. Ethiopia does business all around the world. You have to think for a moment, is this his official business, or did Luke, after the story was done, look back and write his true motive? Now think about that. Luke's writing this after the fact, so he could have said, if he wrote it in live time, he probably would have said the Ethiopian's traveling to do business. But looking back, knowing the man got saved, knowing he was very interested in spirituality and buys an Isaiah scroll, he mentions really the truth. He probably mixed business with pleasure here. He probably did business and made sure he was in the vicinity to be able to worship. So this was his underlying motive. He was now returning, seated in his carriage, kind of like a think of a chariot. About four people can stand there in a standing rider. He was reading out loud, which is common. They always did read out loud. They even do it at the Wailing Wall today. From the book of the prophet Isaiah. Hold on a second. What's he doing with Isaiah? Hebrew's not his mother tongue. His Hebrew's broken. The common language to dialogue and to do merchant trade is Greek. Jews were usually trilingual in Greek. Everyone roughed out Greek a little bit, kind of like English today. The Jews, of course, had Hebrew, and they would flip to Aramaic a bit. For Ethiopia, an Ethiopian to know Jewish language, it's probably broken. In a moment, Philip's going to hear him read and probably notice he's mispronouncing things. He probably understands a little bit. This man probably is very familiar with the Jewish culture, but he's got a book of Isaiah. Now, here's what it takes to get a scroll of Isaiah. We often pass over this. The scroll of Isaiah, to buy a scroll, this is not like print on demand today. You can't just say, I would like chapter 4 of this book, please. Can I download it? They're transcribing. They're writing it. Hebrew is written right to left. Back of the book to the front. This is a scroll. We have in our possession as human beings in the book of the scroll and the book of other antiquities there in Israel, and I've seen it. There is a 1000 BC scroll of Isaiah. And by the way, it was incredibly, incredibly, incredibly identical to the Isaiah you're holding in your Bible today. It's amazing how God preserves his word. It is 24 feet long. It is about 10 to 10 and a half centimeters or inches tall. Think of it this way. If you looked at a picture of it, it would look like it's a bunch of pages stuck together. So in our terms, think of an 8 and a half by 11 piece of paper. So it was only about 10 inches tall. 8 and a half by 11 is 11. And think about pasting 33 of these back to back to back to back to back to back to back. That's how long this scroll is. To buy it would cost 1 drachma per 4 lines. It had over 1,500 lines. So, for all you mathematicians out there, 1 drachma, 4 lines. Drachmas, the cost of a day's wage for a middle-class employee. He was not a middle-class employee, but if you were middle-class, 4 drachma. You had 54 columns of 28 lines a column, long and short. 1.07 years wage, a little over a year's wage. Now, I don't think for a moment that this guy is like Judas Iscariot because he's treasure, he's stealing from the bag. Judas, Gospel of John says that he pilfered from the bag daily. The Ethiopians just paid very well. But listen, you do not buy a book for 1 year's wage just to check it out and see if it's a good book. That's when you watch the movie first and you're like, something, this is a book to read. There's probably more detail. You don't spend a year's worth of wages to check it out for the first time. There must be something in that book that gives hope. There must be something in that writing that he wanted to possess himself. This passage tells us one of the passages. He was pondering at the moment he saw Philip. But I guarantee you, just 11 inches over on that scroll, in column 46, compared to 44 of Isaiah 53 is Isaiah 56. And I guarantee you that he was first running to that chapter. So Philip goes to Gaza. In verse 27, as we read, the eunuch goes to Jerusalem to worship. He's now on his way back in the carriage, reading aloud from the book of Isaiah. The Holy Spirit, now mind you, Philip is 40 miles away. Philip, I've got some activity. I want you to go over and I want you to walk along this carriage. So he goes 40 miles and finally says, here's why I brought you to this dusty road. You see that carriage over there? I want you to walk over there. Now, by the way, you must know that this guy's got massive security. He's got an entourage. There is no question about it. It's in history books and all that. So he would have a personal assistant, he would have a driver, and he would have security guards that would either ride with him or on the side. Some suggest there were maybe seven to 12 people, all male, that were here. So Philip's like, so that's why you brought me here, that guy. I don't even know who that guy is. Verse 30, I don't care. Philip ran. And he probably ran faster the more he heard this guy reading from the prophet Isaiah. So he stands aside, and there's his inn. Do you know what you're reading? Great inn. Do you understand what you're reading? Verse 31, the man replied, how can I unless someone instructs me? Maybe instructs him in the grammar. Maybe instructs him in the language. Maybe certainly also instructs him in the theology. So he urged Philip to come up. That means his security would give him a pass. By the way, they did have clearing strategies, you know, so you hear sometimes police pat people down. They had an inspection process as well, so he probably went through that. And he went up to the carriage, and he sat right beside him. This big old scroll, 54 columns. The passage he read is in column 44. 28 lines worth. Verse 32, here's what the passage was reading. So that means his right hand is full of the scroll, and the left, because they read right to left, the left side's getting a little slim. So he's in the 44th column out of 54. 28 lines, here we'll let it read. Verse 32, the passage of the scripture had been reading like this. This is Isaiah 53, 7 and 8. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter. As a lamb is silent before his shearers, he did not open up his mouth. He was humiliated and received no justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. In verse 34, he asked Philip, can you tell me if this writer is talking about himself or someone else? And I love this next verse. Oh, it's so great. Verse 35. So beginning with that same Old Testament scripture, Philip told him about the good news of Jesus. In the Old Testament, folks, Jesus was on the road to Emmaus, and it says that he began from the beginning of the scriptures to the end and described to them himself. Philip, just like his Lord, is on a dusty road to Gaza and follows his finger right to left, top to bottom, and starts saying, this passage is about Jesus. 3 years ago, sir, in the city that you just visited, we all witnessed a man get crucified. But just as this Isaiah scroll predicts, 703 years ago, he was humbled for us. He took our sin upon us, Verse 32, he was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and a man was silent before shears. He didn't even talk in front of Pilate that moment. He didn't open his mouth. He was humiliated and received no justice. In fact, one of our first century historians say he didn't even look like the form of a man. They plucked his beard out. They beat him with a scourge, a flagellum of whips, and they put a bag on his head and said, if you're really God, predict who just hit you and smote you. And he, like a lamb, just didn't open his mouth. He was humiliated, received no justice. Trust me, he was so framed in this scenario. You should have been there, because I was. Who can speak of his descendants, for his life was taken from the earth? But I want to tell you this, that same God is that died 3 years ago, was dead for 3 days. He is the reason why I can stand in front of you and give you good news, because the God is not dead. He is surely alive today. And God had that plan to save our souls. Just preach if God takes you somewhere. He'll figure out all the other nuances, but if God directs you to people or places or things, or don't know what you're doing, or a new workplace, and you're like, why is God calling me here? We'll find out the finer details. But I do know one thing's clear. When he defines your journey and puts you at an intersection, a defining moment in your life, and you go in this direction or that, one thing is clear. Just preach the gospel. Philip says, that passage is why I have hope. What you're reading is why I have something to say and why you can have hope. Verse 36, as they rode along, they came to some water. The eunuch said, look, there's some water. Why can't I be baptized? Notice this phrase, why can't I? Can't I be baptized? Different translations say, what hinders me to be baptized? What keeps me from being baptized? You have a translation, it all changed. It's a term that means what prevents, what hinders me, what withholds me, what keeps me from, what denies me, what refuses me access. Why? What are the boundaries and the guardrails? Why am I prevented? Why can't I? Note that word, it'll come back in a moment. What handicaps me now? What handcuffs me? What keeps me from proceeding? So Philip said, absolutely nothing. Verse 38, the Ethiopian ordered the carriage to stop, and when they went down into the water, Philip baptized them. I love what the Lord's doing at this church. God is doing great things. Next Sunday, we're going to baptize a woman who has just a beautiful journey of forgiveness. It's so wonderful. I can't wait. The following Sunday, we'll see a father baptize his son. He said, you better do it. I'll be just up here because I won't even be able to speak because my boy's with me. The following Sunday in April, we're going to see a family of six baptized. And then I got a call Thursday, from one of our members, little Thomas Taylor, 7 years old. He gets baptized or saved in Awanas. He's in a godly home and they hear truth. He's saturated with truth. Parents were very careful, like we were, not to prod and push the children, make them make their decision. They said, when they make their own decision, we will know it's a real, real decision. Well, he informed them Thursday that he accepted Christ, and then he had another insisting request. He says, I need to call Pastor Ben right now. She did not ask him to. So can you imagine? I'm sitting in a crowd, and I get this wonderful voicemail that I just wanted to shoot and hoop and holler and shout right in the crowd. And I did. In fact, my whole family did. We called him on the phone. T- Thomas is a funny guy. I go, is this Thomas? He goes, no, it's Bob. And I said, well, my name's Walter. It's about souls. What hinders you from accepting Christ? Nothing. No matter your age, no matter your background, no matter what you've done in your life, no matter if you feel that you've scarred your life to the point where you cannot be redeemed. You can be forgiven by God. He can draw you intimate. This Ethiopian was so stunned that he would receive the grace of God. Well, shouldn't anyone be stunned that he receives the grace of God or she receives the grace of God? Sure. But you accept it a lot when you've been rejected a lot. When he got baptized, verse 39, they came out of the water and the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. Just snatched him away. And now notice this next phrase. The eunuch came up out of the water, did not see him, and did not care. Because it's not about Philip. Look at that last phrase. He came out of the water, never seeing Philip again, but he went on his way rejoicing. When you get saved, there's rejoicing. Do I not need to remind you that in heaven, the angels of the Lord throw a party over an Ethiopian that accepts Christ? A skeptical foreigner? One who they held a prejudice against? Or a seven-year-old? Matter of what we eat or drink, but by living a life of goodness and peace and great joy in the Holy Spirit. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 11. Those who have been ransomed by the Lord will return. They will enter Jerusalem with singing, crowned with everlasting joy. Sorrow and mourning will disappear, and they will be filled with great joy and gladness. Isaiah 55, verse 12. You will live in joy and peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song. The trees of the field, they will all clap their hands in great joy. When God brings the good news, it is a message of great joy. And this man did not care who delivered it at this point. All he cared about was that he was fully received, no longer hindered. But I want you to see two final thoughts. If you're Philip right now, you better watch your pride, because God's really using you, is he not? Philip has cathedrals named after him today. The Lord told him to be chosen one of seven people in Acts chapter 6 to serve tables, and then he elevates this commoner, but this believer, during persecution, to begin preaching in Samaria, and tons of people get saved and demons get cast out, and the magician of the day that was ruling that town repents. He even calls the apostles to verify all his action. Now he's got lots of mass crowds. Now the Lord's calling on him, special ops. Go 40 miles down the road, go to Gaza. I'm gonna have you embark and engage with the finance director of Ethiopia. And that guy accepts Christ, and now he has on his resume that he baptized the guy. If you're Philip, you better really watch your pride, right? Except it's all gonna be good if you're in this ministry for God's glory and not yours. That's exactly what Philip was in it for. Because the Lord snatched him away, and I want you to see the very last verse. He snatched him away, verse 40. Meanwhile, Philip found himself farther north at a town called Azotus, is the phrase. It's known in the Old Testament as Ashdod. 1 Samuel chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, this is where the Philistines stole the Ark of the Covenant, and the Ark, the presence of God, was like causing everyone to die, and those that didn't die got tumors, it says in the Hebrew kind of equivalent for cancer. The presence of the God was in this city, and back in 1 Samuel 5, they couldn't handle the presence of God. They're like, we got to get this out of here. It's piercing the darkness. New Testament, he zaps Philip, plants them right into that city. It is a Palestinian city. They had put up temples. Rome had annexed it. So finally, it's run by Rome. They're all celebrating, honoring Caesar Augustus as God. And get ready once again for the presence of God to come in and start piercing through the darkness. Read what he does. He enters that city and he preached the good news. What should we expect? He preached the good news there and in every town on the way, 40 miles up the road to Caesarea. Is Philip done? No, I'm in Caesarea. What's he gonna do? You wanna take a guess? He preaches the gospel. Caesarea Maritime. There are two Caesareas in the Bible. This is the one on the coast. He preaches the gospel, preached the gospel of Samaria, preached the gospel of Gaza, goes to Ashdod and starts preaching the gospel. And then it says he goes town to town to town to town and just preaches the gospel and finally gets into Caesarea. Watch this. For 3 years, he preaches the gospel. He ends up staying there. He ends up living there. He starts his family there. We learn in Acts chapter 21, verse 8, that he has four daughters there that the Apostle Paul and Luke actually visit later on. They call him Philip the Evangelist. And he preaches the gospel. So unlike Samaritans, who were half Jewish, half Samaritan, he shares the gospel to an Ethiopian, which is the most radical Gentile you can imagine at the end of the earth. Who converted the first Gentile? Philip did. Watch this. Why all of us in church circles think Peter did and Peter did and Peter gets credit. Do you remember? He goes to Caesarea from this verse, verse 40. 3 years lapse and then it hits Acts 10. Peter sees a vision and says, don't call anything that I've called unclean, clean. You need to eat what I've created. No one is unclean. And also you need to share the gospel with Gentiles. There's a man in Caesarea named Cornelius. Cornelius gets a vision and says, you need to go send for Peter and to come back. So he's in Joppa. That's one of the cities that Philip preached. So he sends two messengers and he says, grab Philip or grab Peter. I need you to come to Caesarea. So when Peter gets to Caesarea and meets Cornelius, he leads Cornelius and his whole house to the Lord. And Acts chapter 11, verse 8, when Peter is telling the story to the Jewish people where they're like, why are you sharing this detail? You shouldn't be sharing it with Gentiles. Acts 11, verse 18, Peter said, the gospel goes to the Gentiles, and they said this, quote, when others heard this, they said, now we can see that God has also given the Gentiles the privilege of repenting of their sins and receiving eternal life. And we all go to Acts 11, 18 and said, see, first Gentile converted. You know who is sitting right there in the neighborhood just watching this happen? Philip primed the pump. He laid the groundwork. How could Cornelius even know about the message of Christianity if it wasn't for Philip, who goes to Caesarea and for 3 years, he is just preaching the news of the gospel and he does not care who closes the deal. He does not care who gets the credit for it. Peter is the first apostle to lead a Gentile to Christ. Peter is the first apostle to affirm that the Gentiles do indeed receive the grace and the Holy Spirit like the Jewish people did. But Philip was the one who said, I'm just going to be available. And I led this first Gentile to the Lord in Ethiopia. And by the way, that Ethiopian eunuch historically started the church of Ethiopia and started a revival down in Africa. And he's just here. And everyone's applauding Peter and going, this is so great. And Philip's like, I don't care because it's not about me. It is about the glory of God. Verse 39, this second thought. When God brings life change, there's joy. You remember when you accepted Christ? Do you remember that moment when the Lord gripped your heart? I dare say there's some of you sitting here going, Ben, you would have never guessed 1 year ago that I would have ever been sitting in a church house. You ever believe for a moment growing up that my parents believed that I would ever be praising the Lord in a house of worship? You remember that moment the Lord got a hold of your life? There was joy. This man in verse 39, when they came out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch never saw him again, but went on his way rejoicing. Why? Verse 36. This is why. As they rode along, they came to some water. The eunuch said, look, there's some water. What hinders me? What hinders me? What prevents me? What stops me? What restricts me? Why can't I? What withholds me? What denies me? What denies me access? This was a moment in his life, because when a eunuch goes to worship, Leviticus 21 and Deuteronomy 23 says that you have a permanent blemish upon your life. You cannot enter into the courts. Just like tax collectors, remember that parable in Luke where the Pharisee is praying and it says, and the tax collector stood afar off. In the Pharisee's eyes, there were choices you could make that would not allow you total, full intimacy with God. When man makes the rules, there's prejudice and there's bias and there's restrictions and there's guilt and there's shame and there's no forgiveness that can relieve the heart of man fully. Let me read for you what the Pharisee said. What the Pharisee said about a eunuch coming and wanting to worship. This is from Josephus. He said, quote, Pharisees. Pharisees would say, let those that have made themselves eunuchs be a detestation. Do avoid any conversation with them who are depriving themselves. Let such a one be driven away, as if they've killed their own children. For it is evident that while their body was cut away, they have also transferred that condition to their very souls. In like manner, when you look on one that has this condition, look on them as having a monstrous nature. This man came to worship. This man wanted to read the scriptures. This man wanted to hear truth of how he can be received, but mankind never let him. And this man would go 120-day round trip just to stand on the outside walls of the Jerusalem courts just to get a semblance of the presence of God. So now when Philip comes, he turns to Isaiah 53 and said, that's how hope was provided. But can I also, sir, turn your scroll just two columns away, 11 inches from this column, and can I read you the hope that God gives you? Isaiah 56, verses 4 through 7. Here's why I believe this Ethiopian bought this scroll. Isaiah 56, 4 through 7, quote, for this is what the Lord says. I will bless the eunuchs who keep my Sabbath days holy and who choose to do what pleases me and commit their lives to me. I will give them within the walls of my house a memorial, a name far greater than sons and daughters can give. The name I give them will be an everlasting name. It will not be cut off. I will also bless foreigners who commit themselves to the Lord, who serve him and love his name, and who worship him and do not desecrate the Sabbath rest, and who hold fast my covenant. Verse 7, I will bring them to my holy mountain of Jerusalem. I will fill them with joy in my house of prayer. I will accept their offerings, their sacrifice, because my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. The sovereign Lord who brings back the outcasts of Israel says, I will bring others to me outside of the children of Israel. Philip comes out of the water. When he came out of the water, verse 39, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch never saw him, but he went away with joy. Why did he go with joy? Verse 36, here's water. What hinders me? What prevents me? What's holding me back? What's not allowing me to? Is there anything hindering me? Because I've wanted to do this step of declaration that I'm now a child of God. Man held me back because my prejudice and bias, and I made horrible choices that scarred my life, I thought forever. And the answer is, nothing holds you back. When God changes a heart, he brings joy to the heart. He can save him, and he can save you too.
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Sing this out, church. If you're a believer, this is your story. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Yeah! We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Come on, sing this out, church.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in this house. There is joy in this house today. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, praise him. Let's make this a house of prayer, whatever posture is most conducive for you to utter your prayers to the Lord. You can stand, you can sit, you can kneel. Doesn't matter what I do, anyone else does. This becomes a house of prayer now. Oh, our prayer time is so clear. Pray to the Lord. Lord, let me make you famous in everything I do. Lord, help me bring you more glory, more glory, more glory. Help me to not just increase, or you increase and me decrease. Help me to disappear. God, forgive me when I've stolen your glory. This week, oh God, put me in a situation where I can bring you glory. May I take advantage of the opportunity, and like Philip, may I run to it, not question it, just run. And when I'm in there, may I bring you glory. Help me bring you great glory, God. Also pray to the Lord. Lord, give me a heart for souls. Give me a heart for the unlovely. Give me a heart for people where society discards, disrespects. Help me love the people that are sin against me, that hurt me. Give me wisdom on how to deal with them. But Lord, don't take the love out of my heart for them, because by God's grace, so was I. Give me a heart for people. Those that feel that they've scarred their life forever, can I have the privilege, oh God, of giving them hope? Put me in an opportunity where I can bring the good news of Jesus to give people hope. Chad, lead us, would you?
Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for your word. Thank you for preserving your holy word for us, so that we can see not only in our own lives how you've been faithful, but how you've been faithful for thousands of years. You've been faithful forever, since before we were here. God, I know that you have called your church, you call your people to tell everyone about you. And God, thank you for wonderful examples like Philip. But Lord, he does not have to be an outlier. He does not have to be unique. Each one of us, if we would truly just surrender to you, could be just like him. And Father, the gospel was not any more exciting for Philip than it is for us. It's the same gospel. It's redemption from death to life. That's what happened to Philip, and he went and told everyone. So God, purify your bride, purify your church. Take away our idols, take away the distractions, the things that keep us from thinking of you and for dedicating our entire life and submitting to you. Remove those things, so that each person in the body of Christ, each member that is your bride, Lord, we would just go out. We would go out and we would tell everyone, I used to be dead, now I'm alive, and you can be too. Because my Savior, my God, is alive. And you are on the throne. Thank you that you are already reigning, Jesus. We do not put you in your place. You have taken your place. And now we just get to worship you there. Father, let your will be done. And let us be obedient. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All God's people said, amen. Amen. God be praised. On behalf of the Grove family, I want to thank each and every one of you for coming on this very cold day. There is a reason why it is cold today. I invited some people from Michigan to come, and they brought the weather. Would you welcome my parents, my mom and dad, Ben and Eileen, here? And it has been great to have them here. They were looking forward because they checked the weather last week for the 80 degrees and the 70 degrees. And I'm like, what'd you do? So I'm like, don't worry, blink, it'll be warm again. But if you're our guest, we are so glad that you're here. We have a very special gift for you. Trust me, you'll want to have it. Just swing by the welcome desk. Just tell them Pastor Ben sent you, and they will give you a great gift. You can probably even use it as soon as you leave. But on behalf of the Grow family, I love you folks. Thank you for keeping God's word first and encouraging us to continue to do it as well. And if we don't, our paths don't cross till next week. We'll come next week, because next week is the last Sunday of the I Want In sermon series before we begin prepping for Easter. God bless you. Have a great week. This is my testimony.